said Saul was afraid of David because the Lord was with him. Really, I can stop right there. Says, but he had departed from Saul, talking about the Spirit of the Lord. Therefore, Saul removed him, David, from his presence and placed David as his captain over 1,000. And he went out and came in before the people. David was successful in all his ways. And we hear that phrase again. And the Lord was with him. When Saul saw that he was very successful, he was afraid of him. Now Israel and Judah loved David because he went out and came in before the Lord. That passage in Isaiah, I'm going to ask you to turn there. Isaiah chapter 7, I'm going to read verse 14. It says, therefore, the Lord himself shall give you a sign. The virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel. Those of y'all that have been to church for a little while, you know that name means God with us. The Bible says that David excelled and succeeded because God was with him. Then the prophet Isaiah comes a little later and prophesies and says, this will be a sign that this virgin will bear a child. And they will call his name Emmanuel, which means God with us. Amen. God, we thank you for your presence is already here. You've already conditioned the hearts to hear your word. Now I pray that you would help me to deliver what you've given me for your glory, for your honor and your praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want to share with you today from the very simple topic, he is with us. He is with us. David succeeded because God was with him. And the prophet said that he shall be called Emmanuel, meaning God with us. How many of you all know this morning that everybody has a story? 1998, CBS correspondent Steve Hartman, some of you know that name, he began employing an interesting strategy in order to find stories to write about. And this is a true story, what I'm about to share. He would literally take a dart and toss it at a map of the United States, and wherever it landed, he and his cameraman would travel to that location. When he got to that location, he would find a telephone book. He would flip through the pages of the telephone book and pick a random name. He would contact that person and explain that he was a news correspondent and that he wanted to do a story on them. All right. Didn't matter who they were and it didn't matter what they had to say. If they agreed to meet him to do the story, he would do the story and put it on the airwaves. Once that person would agree to meet with him, he would take a couple days and they would tell him their story, who they were, where they were born, the unique life experiences that they had encountered. In other words, he wanted them to help him get a story of their life so that he could print it for all population to see. The story goes this way, that Steve Hartman did this from 1998 until 2004 when he accepted a job at 60 Minutes. When it was all said and done, he had released stories from people with ages ranging from 5 years old, a five-year-old child, up to the age of an 87-year-old woman. And guess what Steve Hartman named this project? Everybody has a story. You see, Hartman believed that if there were 275 million people in the United States, then there were 275 million different stories to be told. Everybody has a story to be told. The person sitting next to you has their own story, and you got your own story, but everybody's story hadn't been written. The blessed thing is that not only do you have a story, but our Savior has a story. And the good thing is that His story has been written for all the world to see in the pages of Scripture. We get the pleasure of watching His story unfold. We get the pleasure of seeing how His story unfolds. In the book of Genesis, it begins where the Father tells us that a seed of woman would come into the earth and He would crush the hand of Satan. That's the beginning of His story. His story is told throughout the subsequent pages of Scripture. And I don't know about you, but I'm glad that He didn't just write a story that involved Him alone, but He wrote me and you into His story. We also have a place in His story. But during this time of year, which the Christmas season is, this is a time that we take to recognize and appreciate one part of His story. The portion that tells us that He left the throne of heaven. And He set aside His heavenly garments and clothed Himself in human flesh. The prophet Isaiah talks about this in Isaiah 9:6. He says, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son has been given, and the government will be upon His shoulders, and He will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." Now, I know Him to be wonderful. I know Him to be my counselor. I know Him to be the Almighty God, the Everlasting God, and I certainly know Him to be my Prince of Peace. Somebody ought to say amen right there. And I come to learn that there are many names that He's called in Scripture, but in telling His story, there's one name I want to focus on this morning. And it's found in Isaiah 7:14. Isaiah says, "Therefore the Lord Himself will give you a sign. Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and His name shall be called Emmanuel." That means God is with us. It's great to know that He loves us, but it's an entirely different comfort level to know that He is with us. Now, I don't know about you, but I'm thankful for my Savior. I'm thankful that He's my Savior. I'm thankful and I'm glad that He's my healer. And I appreciate the fact that He's my comforter. And I feel secure in knowing that He is my protector. And encouraged to know that He is my deliverer. But can I tell you that when life seems as if it can't get any harder, against all my problems, I praise God that I know that He is with me. He is my Emmanuel. If you've been saved for any amount of time, then you've come to learn that some things in your life you just have to go through. As much as you like for God to move it out of your way, some stuff He just won't fix for you. You just got to walk through it. Some stuff you just got to be willing to just walk straight on through it. And I've come to the place that I can be okay with having to go through some stuff as long as I know that He is with me. This is why Moses was able to lead the children of Israel out of Egyptian bondage, because he was with him. This is why Joshua was able to lead the overthrow of Jericho without lifting a finger in battle, because he was with them. This is why the Hebrew boys were able to survive being thrown into a golfing incinerator without even a fiber of their clothes being singed, because he was with them. The Bible says that's why David didn't become a delicacy for the lion when he was in the lion's den, because he was with him. If you were to ask Gideon how he defeated the Midianites, he would tell you simply because God was with me. If you could talk to the prophet Elijah and say, "How did you defeat the prophets of Baal on Mount Carmel?" he would simply say, "Because God is with me." If you said, "Well, Elijah, how did you stay sane while you were waiting on the mountaintop and stay sane in the valley?" he would say, "Because when I was on the mountaintop, he was with me. And when I'm in the valley, he is still with me." The Bible says that Paul had a thorn in his flesh, and he was able to thrive even with the thorn. Why? Because he was with him. even went to the grave and got back up from the dead. Why? Because he was with him. Can I tell you today that as long as God is with you, you can walk through any fire without being burned, and you can survive the waves without being drowned. I'm going to preach in a minute. In fact, Isaiah 43:2 says that when you pass through the fire, or when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, and you shall not be scorched. Can I tell you, LBHT, that God sent me by this morning to be a prophetic voice to somebody to tell you that he is with you today. You may not see him, you may not feel him, but he is with you today. Deuteronomy 31:6, he speaks to the man of God. He says, be strong and of good courage. Do not fear nor be afraid of them. For the Lord your God, he is the one who goes with you. Thank God he goes with us. He said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Nearly 2,000 years ago, if our greatest need had been for information, God would have simply dropped the internet out of heaven. If our greatest need had been for technology, he would have simply sent us a master engineer. If our greatest need was to understand science, he would have simply caused our birth a Pulitzer Prize scientist to give us what we need. If our greatest need had been money, he would have simply dropped an infinite amount of money from heaven to this earth and said, go and have some fun. But he understood that our greatest need was forgiveness. So he sent us a savior. He sent us one that would save us. And the whole reason he saved us was to have relationship with us. And the reason he has relationship with us is to be with us. Can I tell you, God knows exactly what we need, and when we need him, he is with us. Now when Isaiah prophesied these words of God sending a son, it was important to them, particularly because he identified him in a different way than they had heard before. He had a different name to offer them than what they had heard. They had known God was who he was, and thus some of them had actually chosen to follow him. But Isaiah's prophecy is good news to them because it meant they would one day see him in a different way than they had ever seen him before. See, the name Emmanuel, which means God with us, in the original language, it meant more than just him being available or being God who would hear you when you pray. But the name actually meant the God whom they had served and whom they had prayed to would now take an extra step. He would go beyond just inclining his ear to hear you when you speak to him, but he would take an extra step to leave heaven, to leave his heavenly throne and come to the earth and literally dwell with us in the person of God. Can I tell you that it's God's desire to do a more than love us from a distance? God desires to do more than just love us from a long-handled spoon, but he wants to have up close and personal relationship with us. And that's what prompted him to leave heaven, to come to earth, to die for us so that he could be with us. See, the story of scripture is not a story of man's desire to be with God, but it's a story of God's desire to be with man. Sometimes life may unfold in a way you don't want it to. We all should say amen to that. But you can walk in victory, I came to tell you this morning, as long as you remember that he is with you. I want to use the backdrop of 1 Samuel chapter 18, verses 12 through 16 this morning to show you the marks of when God is with you. The marks of when God is with you. I read the scripture earlier where the Bible says that Saul started getting salty with David. Saul started getting frustrated within. In fact, the scripture says, and if you turn there, I want you to just walk through it with me, 1 Samuel chapter 18, verse 12. The scripture says that Saul was afraid of David because the Lord was with him. Now, I'll give you a little background so that you can stick with me here. You have to understand that this passage was written in the context of David having just defeated the giant Goliath. And the people are now admiring David. They're saying, this is a great man. He's done something that none of the other folks here, including our king, could have done or was willing to do. And the king at the time was King Saul, and he became jealous of David. He became jealous, and from that point on, he began looking for ways to destroy David and to disrupt God's plans and purposes for David's life. But we pick up in verse 12 where it shows the true state of King Saul's heart towards David and why he wanted to persecute him. Look at verse 12. You got it in your Bible? It says, now Saul was afraid of David because the Lord was with him. The Lord had been with David helping him defeat Goliath, and Saul had taken notice of that. We see an example of God being with us back in Genesis chapter 39, where verse 2 tells us that even while Joseph was in a strange land, it says the Lord was with Joseph and he was a successful man. You see, when God is with you, he will always cause you to succeed. We see another example in 2 Kings 18:7 where it says, King Hezekiah, the Lord was with him and he prospered wherever he went. And the scripture tells us in direct terminology in Romans 8:37, yet in all these things, we are more than conquerors. We are successful through him who had loved us. Can I tell you that when God is with you, he always causes you to succeed. 1 Corinthians 15:57 says, but thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. When God is with you, you win every single time. You don't have to despair today, though you may find yourself in a tough place or in a place where the odds may be stacked against you. God is with you, and because he's with you, you will win.
Amen.
David was the only one of the people who had enough sense to know that God was with him. So this young Hebrew boy, with no background in leading in war, went on the offense against the giant Philistine and defeated him. Are you with me? And the X factor was this. The X factor was not that he was feeling particularly brave that day. I don't know about you, but some days you get up, you don't feel real saved. The X factor was not that he was feeling particularly brave that day, or that he had a host of people behind him who were going to help him fight. In fact, most of them said, we're scared. And we're not afraid to say we're scared. And so you on your own on this one. So that was not the X factor. But can I tell you what the X factor was? The X factor was that he had the Almighty God who was with him. He had the one the psalmist called the Lord of hosts. The Lord mighty in battle was with him. That same God is with you today. Can I tell you that the Lord of hosts, the Lord mighty in battle, is with you today. And you don't have to despair or fret because of the battles that are on the giants that are facing you, because you are not alone. See, David knew what it was like to fight with no other credentials than to have God with him. He knew what it was like to be demeaned and minimized, and for people to be condescending towards him, knowing that he had no other credentials. In fact, if you look in 1 Samuel chapter 17, you'll see where King Saul tried to minimize him and tell him that you're only a youth. You don't have the credentials to make war against this giant. You don't have what it takes to go out and fight against this giant. Some audacity that King Saul had when the rest of his mighty warriors were afraid and were hiding behind the trees, And he tells this young man, you don't have the credentials. But David had become used to doing what others said he couldn't do because he didn't have the credentials to do so. He tells Saul, he says, well, sir, I'm used to fighting battles that are beyond my credentials and where the odds are stacked against me. He tells him in verse 34 through 37, he says, you see, king, while I was keeping my father's sheep, a lion took one of the lambs from the flock, and I went out and I fought the lion, and I recovered the lamb and brought him back. And when the lion tried to attack me, you see, I'm not a man of war, but when the lion tried to attack me, I caught him by his mane, and I killed him with my bare hands. See, king, because the God of Israel was with me. On another occasion, he said, king, there was another time when a bear tried to do the same thing. He tried to steal one of these lambs. He tried to think that he could take my lambs from me, but I went and found the bear, and I ripped the lamb from his mouth. And when the bear tried to swipe me with his paw, I used nothing but the hand of God. No credentials, no spear, no arrow, but God was with me, and I killed the bear with my bare hands. He goes further and says, king, and just in case you haven't gotten a picture yet, that same God that calls me to fight the bear and fight the lion is the same God that's with me right now. But as I go a little further, verse 13 tells us that when God is with you, he gives you favor in the sight of others. Let's look at verse 13. Therefore Saul removed him from the presence and placed him in the over captains of 1,000. And he went out and came in before the people. Now this is a time where you have to really read this to see what's happening. The Bible says Saul removed David from his presence and put him in a place where he didn't have to be bothered with him no more. I tell you that sometimes folk will try to hinder and disrupt what God is doing in your life, and they think they're getting rid of you. Put you in a place where they ain't got to be bothered with you no more. But I love that when God is with us, he always changes the equation. People are trying to do vindictive stuff, things that they're trying to do to hurt you. But in reality, when God is with you, he will always give you favor in the sight of man. The Bible says Saul put David in a different place. Hear me now, listen. He put him as captain over 1,000. Now appreciate this. You got to back up a few verses and look at verse 7, where the people came in singing and they said, God has given David Saul his thousands and David his 10,000s. That's the reason that Saul got frustrated in the first place. Perhaps this was Saul's way of downgrading David in the sight of the people, to say, I hear them saying that you're ruling over tens of thousands, but I want them to see that I'm putting you in a place over in the corner where you're only over 1,000. This will force them to see you in a smaller light, David. While you may think you're bold, they will see you and minimize you and realize that you have been thrown away, David. But verse 14 tells us that David knew how to handle himself in adverse circumstances. Look at verse 14. David was successful in all his ways, and the Lord was with him. He understood that he knew how to handle himself. In fact, in some verses it says that David behaved wisely. He behaved wisely. He understood how to handle himself because he knew God was with him. Yeah. Yeah. Can I tell you something, saints, today? When life presents you with adverse circumstances, you have to make sure that you behave wisely. You have to make sure that you understand how to handle yourself in adverse circumstances if you want God to be with you. Verse 15 says again that Saul became afraid when he saw that David behaved wisely. In spite of his foolishness, Saul became afraid. And in verse 16, it tells us that David could not be limited to the place where Saul had put him as captain over 1,000. You see, back in verses 13 and 14, where Saul says, I'm going to minimize you. I can't totally get rid of you because the people recognize that there's some power in you. And so instead of me acknowledging that you are a captain over tens of thousands, I'm going to put you as a captain over 1,000. And the Bible says that David just held his peace. He behaved wisely in the midst of trouble. David didn't start cussing and fussing. He didn't start quoting scripture. He didn't start getting frustrated with people and angry with people. He didn't go and try to make his case to Saul as to why he didn't deserve that treatment. He just said, boss man, if you this is the way you want to do it, then I'm okay with that. And the Bible says he behaved in a good way despite how the boss treated him. But look at what verse 16 says. You see, when God is with you, God will show you favor in the sight of man. While he put him in charge of 1,000, the Bible says now all of Israel and Judah loved David because he went out and came in before them. Now I noticed that the scripture didn't say all 1,000 of them, but it said the entire nation loved David. Something happened when light tried to push David into a corner that God opened the light of heaven so that he could be exposed, and the people of God began to love him. God is with you. His favor is shown to you through man. I've learned that people can do whatever they want to do. Some of y'all get mad at your bosses. You get frustrated with your supervisors because they're mistreating you and not giving you what you want. I've learned that when God is with you, it don't really matter. In fact, sometimes God needs to move you out of the way.
Yes.
So that he can show himself as God.
Yes.
And he moved David out of the way. Saul said, I'm going to give him that. He think he's a big man. I'm the boss. I'm still the king. How many know when God decides to act, no king can hold his hand back? When God decides to act, no devil can hold his hand back. No situation that you face or circumstances that you encounter can hold back the hand of God when he decides to act. I know you got some King Sauls in your life that would rather you just go away and would like to put you over to the corner. And the truth be told, some of y'all are your own King Saul. You just tired of your own self. But I came to tell you this morning that God is with you. And when God is with you, there's no demon in hell that can push back or hold the hand of God. I came this morning to release some stuff in the spirit to tell Satan to get his hands off of your stuff and what's happening in your life, because God is with you. And because he is with you, there is no limitation on you. Love the fact that King Saul got even madder. That's like the enemy. When God began to do some stuff, he get even angrier. The Bible said King Saul said, I'm going to kill him now. I tried to put him over in the corner, hoping that he'd just go away quiet. But somehow God had shown him favor. Now I'm going to kill him. That's why you can't get so frustrated and upset when things get worse before they get better. It's just prepping you. Whew, I felt that. It's just prepping you for the favor of God to rest on you. It's just preparing you for where God is taking you. Stop getting frustrated because things are getting worse before they get better. That's a sign that things are turning around. That's a sign that God is in control and he's with you. And your blessing and favor is closer than you think. So you need to learn how to get a hold of yourself. But stop getting worse before it gets better. You've been praying and stuff. Go fasting and praying. And it's getting worse, listen. It ain't getting no better. And I think I need to pray hard. I need to fast hard. Bible says, David didn't do nothing but just behave wise. He didn't make no enemies. He didn't say nothing slick out of his mouth. He didn't try to get nobody back. He just held his peace and behaved wise. I walked with you yesterday, God. I'm going to walk with you today. I know they got me in a corner right now, but I'm just going to behave wisely right now. Some of y'all need to learn that lesson with your own children and your own spouses. Just behave wisely and let God be God and let him show himself strong. David said, I'm not going to act outside of my character. I know him to be the God of all creation. See, he had faith because God had helped him to kill a bear and kill a lion and kill the lion. So surely he would say at this point, King Saul, surely there's nothing that you can do to harm me. I'm just going to shut my mouth. I gotta finish, but I want to illustrate my final point with a couple verses of scripture. Show you how your life is impacted when God is with you. See, I come to find out this same David that had been attacked by the lion and the bear, the same David who had taken a smooth stone and had killed the giant Goliath, is the same David who wrote the words of Psalms 46, where he says, God is my refuge, and he is my strength, a very present help in trouble, a very present help when I'm going through my mess. Therefore, we will not fear, even though the earth be moved, and though the mountains be carried into the sea, though the waters be troubled. Trouble in your life. He says, though the mountains shake with swelling, he is my refuge. In verse 10, he says, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted above the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us, he says. The God of Jacob is our refuge. When God is with you, he's a refuge all for your good. Later in that verse, for that chapter, he says, for I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present or things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God. That pain in my body, that trouble in my home, that messed up finances, that all that's going wrong with me cannot separate me from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus, my Lord. He don't feel the way I want to. He don't feel the way I thought he would. But he is with me. And because he is with me, the writer said, I persuade you. Come on, wait, don't mess my sermon. Every once in a while, the enemy will put a wall in your path. King Saul type wall. That says, I ain't letting you through. You can't pass by me. And so what do? As tongue-talking folk, we fast and speak in tongues and pray and say, God, help me to go around. Take me out of this so I don't have to face it. God, I need you to just take me the easy route so I don't even have to face the resistance. But I came to tell somebody this morning, because you're in the midst of this struggle. You're in the midst of this struggle. I know I ain't preaching everybody, I'm preaching somebody, though. You're in the midst of this struggle. And a King Saul type role has presented itself before you. God said that every once in a while, you've got to just go through. Spirit realm. When God is with you and you think you're alone, and the world is with you, no way I can defeat this devil. There's no way that I can get through this. The Bible says that the Spirit of the Lord will raise up a standard in this room when he's something like a brother. And the things I like about God is that he's a great leader. He don't go nowhere. He don't ask you to go nowhere that he don't know first. And so when you're pacing your walls, the Holy Ghost will get in front of you and say, just stay right here. Watch your back. Stay right here. We're going through this together. We're going through it together. You walk with me and talk with me. And we're going to walk through this wall. But you hear God say, I'm with you. I'm going through this. I'm walking through this with you. And as long as you know that, that's enough for you. So you got to learn to not always question God. You know what? God doesn't have to always owe you an explanation. But as long as you're comforted in knowing that I can't predict what's going to happen, but what I do know is that he is beside me. He's with me. He's walking through this with me. Then you can have peace and you can behave wisely. I'm gonna quit, but listen. Stop posting that foolish stuff on Facebook. Hating otherwise because you want to do something. Stop making enemies out of people that ain't your enemies. Because you're going through a mess. And learn to behave wisely. You know he's with you. Stop responding to people with visceral responses. You don't like what they said or how they treated you. Behave wisely. I know some of y'all like this. All right. Let's praise God. I open my Facebook feed hoping to find something encouraging. And somebody, they throwing up on Facebook. People don't need to know who they messing with. I know y'all don't like it, but I'm a preacher because it's right. And I know that's everybody, but it's somebody. You just flat out telling Satan that he didn't want. He got you acting out of character. You flat out just waving a white flag. I stopped following some people. I know every time they going through something. They mad at the world. They fussing everybody out. And then they get them foolish followers who tag on. I know that's right, child. I hear what you're saying. Well, I know what I'm talking about. I look at them quickly, just get off, say these bunch of fools. You know, I ain't put that in my spirit this morning. Y'all know what I'm talking about. I know all y'all ain't on Facebook, so there may be a generation or two that I'm missing here that's not on Facebook, but I want to offer you some words of wisdom. Don't put all your mess out there. Did you know that it used to be thought this was only relevant to the law enforcement professions? But did you know now that every profession just about, they go back and do a 5-year search of your Facebook and social media pages? 5 years. They get to know what kind of person you are. They get to know how you're going to act when stuff don't go your way. They get to know your social views. They know that if they're going to do something at work, how you going to respond. And they may not ever say it to you, but they ain't going to hire you because they know your character, and they'll give you another reason why. Oh, we had a budget issue. So we had to select someone else. I'm not telling you what I think, I'm telling you what I know. And I'm going to quit, but somebody need to hear this. I don't know whoever you are, you need to hear this. This is God. This is God's way of elevating you and teaching you some things. The Bible says David behaved wisely. Behaved wisely. We've got to learn to behave wisely without mess. Saints, God is with you today. He's always with you. When he's with you, you always succeed. You always win. When he's with you, he always gives you favor in the sight of man. It may take some time, but he will show himself strong. And when he's with you, he's always your refuge. Your head's bowed and your eyes closed. I know this may not necessarily